The head office is in Gariki, Abuja. So obtaining your export license is very easy. Unlike before that, it will take you up to a month, 2 months, some in a year to get export license. Right now, you can get your export license for just 3 days, maximum 1 week, if all things being equal. Okay? I will tell us how to obtain export license. I think is the next slide after this. The next, prepare and plan your export. Remember, when you want to do export, and the first thing is to get the idea. Somebody came to our office and he said, I'm a member of the Dream Business Club. I heard that you people help us to do export. We said, yes. He said, okay. I have 1.5 million I want to export. Then I asked, what do you want to export? He said, I don't know. I said, where are you sourcing that product that you don't even know? He said, no, you just take the money, export, and give. I said, no, we don't do that. We teach people, even as we want you to make money, we teach you how to do it so that you can do it on your own. If like I said yesterday, the business we are doing, after the first business, we believe you must have learned something. So we expect you to open your own and start up. But if you come again for us to give you the fish again, after teaching you how to catch fish, maybe you are playing when we are teaching, we may not really do that again, you know? So you need to plan and prepare your export. Plan and prepare your export is know what you want to export, know how available the product is, where to get them, which country are you going to sell it to? And some people, I know the question somebody is planning to ask me is, how do you get a buyer for the product? I think I'll answer that with some slides coming up too. Okay, the next, secure an export contract. Secure an export contract is get a buyer for your product. Nobody buys anything from you until you have something of value, okay? And even if you have something of value, you need to tell people about it so they can buy. I will also tell us how to secure an export contract soon. Next, process NSP form and pay your NESS scheme. That one you do it through your bank. The government say that they are not collecting duty for export anymore, you know? Nothing like duty, nothing like export duty anymore. But when you import, you pay duty, you pay levy. But when you're exporting, you don't pay anything. You just do your NESS, NXP form. You get it through your bank. You go to your bank that you want to export. You need NXP form. You pay for that to your bank. Though you must have domiciliary account. Okay? Arrange for warehouse and inspection services. You need to arrange for warehouse and inspection services. Now, the warehousing is, if you are getting the product from outside Lagos, you need to bring it to Lagos. And inspection agencies are already in Lagos because some of them, they won't agree to go with you to Kavanchan to inspect your product. So when you bring the product, you have to bring it to a warehouse where you will store them and you call them in to come and inspect the product. So you need to arrange warehouse. The next, engage a freight forwarder. Freight forwarders are those professionals that help you to interact with government agencies. They know the terrain more than you. As in, they can speak that language with the custom, and the custom man will easily understand. I don't know if you understand this now. Okay? Word can change hands. Some other things can change hands, you know, easily with them compared to you if you want to do it yourself. So you engage a freight forwarder. Okay, book a truck and a container. You get trucks from haulage companies, but the container you book it from shipping companies. When you go to the shipping company, you need a container to export. They'll ask you where, you give them the details, they will give you the container to bring your product. Every shipping company wants to give container for export. Why? Because most of the containers, most of the vessels that are leaving Nigeria are ballasted, as in They come with load, they go empty, so they ballast the vessel with water, so the vessel will be stable. And when going empty, they are not making any money. So no matter how small, they want to collect money for the export, and they pay good attention on that. The export manager and shipping company will want to, as in the way they handle you, they pamper you when you are exporting. But if you are importing, the way they will insult you, you know. Same with customs too. Customs don't, they will just check, okay, just check, go, without paying them anything. You know, except if you are carrying those things they say you should not carry. Okay. Loading and sealing of container, you do that in the warehouse. You load the container. After inspection, you load the container and you get custom seal to seal the container. Transportation and GIT, insurance to port. This one is important because most of the trucks we are using in Lagos are not too strong, except you get the good haulage companies that have new trucks and also have insurance in place. If they don't have the insurance, you need to insure them. More so, you know, Apapa Road is very, very good. You know, the potholes there, you can't count them. And I don't know, it's almost in all the ports in Nigeria. Anywhere money is coming from is not always good. The same thing with on a port. Even the refinery road is not wonderful. Okay. The next, custom inspection at the port. The custom will come to inspect. After that inspection in the warehouse, they will just come check the seal number and you go. But if they did not inspect in the warehouse, when you get to the port, they will open the container and look into it. Okay, the next. Delivery to shipping line. You have to deliver the container to shipping line. It's not taking that container to the shipping company, no. Taking the documents, the invoice, now to the shipping company, showing them the paper, they will give you proof. When you bring the container inside the port, they will give you proof to show that this container is in the terminal. So you take that document to the shipping company. By then, you have delivered that container to the shipping company. They will prepare for your bill of lading transport document. Obtaining transport document from shipping lines, they will give you a document called bill of lading. Bill of lading serves three purposes. It's a document of title. Okay? It's a document of title. It serves as a receipt for goods shipped. It's also a negotiable document. With bill of lading, anybody that, why is it a document of title? Why we call it document of title is, if I have a bill of lading, I can collect money from Oga here. I will just show him the bill of lading. These are containers that are going out. I need 5 million. The goods in the bill of lading worth almost 8 million. So he will give me the money and collect the bill of lading. It's a negotiable document. And the holder of the bill of lading can clear the goods. You know? So it's a powerful document. Next is obtaining inspection report from inspection company. The inspection company, we have Cobalt, we have SGS, we have Bureau Veritas, and all others. But you don't choose the inspection company by yourself. You allow your buyer to choose inspection company. Okay, to choose the inspection agency. So if you choose the inspection agency by yourself, maybe when the goods arrive the destination, the buyer will start telling you some stories that this thing is not good, there's moisture content, there's water, and all other stories. But if they choose the inspection agency will make sure they represent the buyer. And the inspection agency will issue you a document called a CCI, that is Clean Certificate of Inspection. With that Clean Certificate of Inspection, your buyer will not tell you stories. It's after all, your inspection agency gave me this to show that everything is well inspected before leaving the terminal, before leaving Nigeria, okay? Obtaining custom document, custom will give you some documents. like the SGD formally, but right now they just have one paper they will give to you because of the we have the technology has increased, so you don't pack too much papers anymore. They either send through the internet or they'll just print one document to give to you as proof. Okay, forwarding document to supplier. You have to forward the document to your buyer, telling your buyer, as in that document will tell your buyer the stage that you have done, you know? And there's something called Incoterm. Incoterm simply means International Commercial Trade Terms. The story of Incoterm, let me just quickly say it. In 1923, ICC, International Chamber of Commerce, found out that there have been lots of problems in interacting, as in the exchange of goods and services. They find out that many people will go for litigations, some arbitrations, calling people to settle case. I gave you 50,000, maybe 5 million to deliver a container for me, and you did not deliver. The man will say, no, you gave me 5 million, and I prepared the container for you. You did not come to collect them, you know? So that amounts to lots of litigation cases before they thought it wise that they should set out three-lettered words, okay, that will serve as a rule in which if you choose any of them, it becomes law, okay? Like the FOB, the CIF, and X-Works, and all that. So they drafted the Incoterms. I can't really talk about Incoterm now because it's too much. We have 2010 Incoterm now, you know, so it's plenty to talk about. Submission of post-export document to your bank. There's something called letter of credit. Call it documentary letter of credit. When you are discussing with your buyer, that is not the best form of payment. Your buyer will tell you which time of payment do you want. Or you ask your buyer what type of payment is he using, you know. The documentary letter of credit is in that there is four parties to that transaction. You, your bank, your buyer, and his bank. Your buyer will instruct his bank to pay to your bank certain amount of money if your own bank agrees that they have collected some specified document from you, you know? So what you just do is, after exporting, you take that document to your bank, give it to them, your bank will cross-check them and pay you. Then your bank will collect the money from the buyer's bank, and the buyer's bank will deduct that money from that buyer's account. That's the documentary letter of credit. So why you forward the document now, why you submit those post-export documents to your bank is because you want to be what? Paid. Next is payment of export proceeds. Once they pay you, that money should be in your domiciliary account. Make sure the money comes in. What some people do, which the government is trying to kick against, is some will export, use that money there to buy goods, import to Nigeria. Then it will be difficult for the country, as in Nigeria, to calculate our GDP, GNP. We can't even calculate our balance of trade to know how many goods went out and how many are coming in, you know. So it will be difficult. So when some people are exporting, but we keep recording deficit to Nigeria just because some of us are not repatriating our proceeds. Okay, the next. How to obtain an export license in Nigeria. Like I said, very, very easy now. First, to obtain an export license, you need to register a limited liability company, like I said before. The following documents should be scanned and uploaded online. So you have to go to www.nepc.gov.ng. When you log into that site, you go to a place called, you see register. you fill the forms there. So you upload this document, the certificate of incorporation, memorandum and article of association with exporter export as one of the objectives of the company, certified true copy of particulars of directors, it's got from CAC2, fill the registration form provided online, registration fee, you pay the registration fee for the certificate only is 13,500 naira. 13,500 for the certificate only, formerly is 5,000 naira. That was 2005, but now it's 13,500 naira. Okay, that is for certificate only. Then for certificate and profiling is 36,000. Profiling is when they do the certificate for you, they will now put your name in forum that when somebody click exporters of ginger in Nigeria, your name will just show up. You know, in the search engine now, it will be easier for buyers to see you. You understand? That is the profile. In next slide. On renewal of certificate, you pay 7,500. For revalidation, 12,005. Lost or mutilated, you pay 12,005. Pay the registration fee online with your debit card or at the nearest designated bank communicated to you. Notification for pickup will be communicated via email. Come with your original document for citing and receipt of payment for the copies included. The export certificate will be issued to you immediately, though sometimes they try to make it, you know, those workers there, you know, for you to willingly give them something. You will no longer call that bribe anymore. Okay, note, the registration with the Nigeria Export Promotion Council, NEPC, to obtain export license can be done within a week, if all things being equal, at the rate of 13,500 naira. Very. Okay, next slide. Exportable products. It's not all commodities that are exportable from Nigeria. Let me deal with the exportable first, and I'll still tell us some products that are not exportable from Nigeria. It's not all products, like I said, okay. Those exportable from Nigeria is cassava. Cassava, you either export it as cassava chips or cassava powder, as in flour, or fufu, as in AKPU, you know, apu. You know, it's also exportable. Next, no, you can, as apu, yes, the men apu, they package it. Yes. Is the way they package it. No, go back, please. Okay. Chili pepper, dry chili pepper is exportable. Though the fresh one also is also exportable. You know? But you have to do that with a reefer container, a refrigerated container. Or you do it via air freight. Okay? Cocoa beans. Very much exportable. We've been doing that since, and it's still on, though the price will go up and come down. Coffee, finished leather, ginger. This is big money if you are exporting ginger. But the challenge now is people are not even farming ginger a lot, and ginger grows everywhere. Ginger can stay under the soil for 2 years and it's still ginger, you know. next, granules, gum arabic horns, that is cow horns. Okay, hibiscus flower, that is zobo, kola nut, rubber, sesame seed, shea nut or shea butter. Next, please. Sesame seed is the what we call Benin seed. You know, we have the white one and we have the black one. The white one is more, as in the price of the white one, it's more compared to the price of the black one. You get sesame seed in large quantity in Benue State. They also have people call it reedy, you know, So it's highly exportable too. Soybeans, hides and skins, wheat pellet, charcoal. Charcoal is still exportable. That is one of the easiest commodity to export now, charcoal, without too much money. If you have up to 750 to, let's say, up to 800,000, you can do charcoal export. Okay, next slide. Securing an export contract. People are afraid, or some people think it's difficult to get contract. Though it's not easy, because the white men are afraid. Even some of us, we are still afraid, because even the white men, they play wayo these days, you know. And some of our guys will close their nose and speak to you. You think they are white and dupe you, you know. So the internet is not really helping too much. But we still get contract via net. We'll give us the website too. Okay, you can go to the International Chamber of Commerce, the branch in Nigeria. Tell them the product you have to export, and they will check through their site for a buyer that buys that product. From there, they can link you. Next is bilateral Chamber of Commerce, like Nigerian German Chamber of Commerce, Nigerian Ghana Chamber of Commerce, British, Nigerian British Chamber of Commerce, and all that. You can Google that and get their address. You can go to their place, they will help you out. If you know a product that drives well in England, can go to Nigerian British Chamber of Commerce, they will look for a buyer for you, you know, from their site. The next, trade brokers. Trade brokers are people that they don't buy, they don't sell. They are middlemen. What they do is they connect buyers and sellers together. You know, they connect them to do business. So that is trade brokers. And they collect commission called brokerage on that. The same thing with consulting firms. But more also is personal contact. Most of us will have some personal contact. We'll have some of them on Facebook. Some of them, we meet them in seminars and all that. You know, you need to contact them, those that live abroad. Ask them what you can offer them. And you can start export from there. Referrals from other exporters, that one don't really work much, because it's not easy for somebody to give you their own buyer. You understand? It's not easy, but some exporters can. Maybe if they are your brother, they can easily say, okay, take this guy, export to him, you know. Then friends and relatives abroad. Instead of calling your brothers, your friends abroad, requesting for dollar or pounds every time, they will stop picking your call, you know. Show them you have something of value. You want to do business with them. Call them. You can call them tonight or tomorrow. What can I send to you over there that you can put in shops, you can deliver in? Because we have Nigerians everywhere. Okay? Nigerian, sometimes, I don't know whether somebody did here, sometimes Gary they hungry or to soak. Like me, sometimes I just feel like to drink Gary. You know? So is to some other Nigerians outside. So you can call your brothers, tell them what can we supply to you. There's basically two types of export. Let me quickly talk about that. Formal and informal export. The formal export is the big one. The formal export is what I'm talking about now, where you do get your NXP form, where you register company and all that. But the informal export, you don't need to register company at all. The informal export is like way billing. We've done informal export for somebody, Gary export. I think Mr. Victor will talk about that if he's here on time. You know, but Ogu, there's a way you cut the Ogu. You don't use your hand to cut, you use scissors. There's carton they sell at NACO. You use that carton to package the Ogu and export it. He's export because he's leaving the country. And you make money too, though it's informal export. When your informal export grows to an extent, you can now do the formal ones, send through containers, send through sea. But one thing is, some people want to start very, very big, and that big time export is not easy to come by most times. So you need to start small, or two or three people do one container. Okay, from the internet, you can just go there now or later, www.alibaba.com, www.alibaba.com, www.tradekey.com, www.ecplaza.net, www.tradebulls.com, and all other sites you can still go through. Okay, but when you are doing that, you have to be careful. When you get a contact from the site, you have to go to the consulate or embassy to confirm that company. Don't just start doing business. Before you know, they will tell you, go to social place. You will see somebody that will give you the product, and you just pay money. Before you know, you just cry loud. It is not our prayer. Next. Planning and preparing for your export. Like I said, these are the things you have to note when preparing for your export. First, it's availability of the market. Where do I sell the commodity? First question, very important. You need to ask yourself, who is my buyer? Where do I even sell it to? Which country needs this product? I did an informal export with one of my friends. We did Oporoku as in stockfish. We did that 2 times. We did yam, though he's a student over there. I don't know whether he used some part of the money to pay school fees. I'm expecting him to come back so we can discuss, you know? So it's good to do export. Export is big. It's big money and it's fast. Fast. Okay, you need to ask your question. Who do I sell it to? Next is capital. How much is required to start this? Where do I buy it? As in, you know where to buy the product now, or you don't know, but how much do you need? You do that calculation. Many reasons we fail in business is 80 or 90% of our businesses don't have business plan. We don't even plan the business at all. We start and believe God that God will do it. Thank God God is doing it. You know, but he said something that who among you before building a house will not sit down and calculate? So we need to take business plan, very, very important. Sometimes you pay people to draft that business plan for you. Start with our business plan. You have 80% failure, as in you can fail. They say that he that fails to plan, plans to fail. That may be true, you know, but please, you need to plan very well. The next is profitability, which is why we do business. Export is a business. Don't treat your business as if it's an NGO. Export is business. And why you go into business is to maximize profit, not even to make profit, to maximize profit. If not, I think in the Bible, there is the parable of talent. The man, they gave one and he refused. He just hid it without using it. Then the man that multiplies his own, they collected and added to him. So God wants us to make profit. So there's no bad thing making profit. We have to be considerate a bit, you know. Okay, sustainability. How long will you continue to supply this product? You may have the product now, but how long can you supply it? Somebody, after hearing about the export, told me one day, I can start this thing, you know, hope we can do palm kernel export. I say, yes. He say, we have palm kernel in our village. enough palm kernel. I said, okay, good. We can start with one container. How many container can you even give in 5 months? He said, container? I'm not sure if it's up to one container. And I said, you don't have palm kernel. You need to, as in, buyers want to do business with you and continue doing business with you, not to just do one container and they are not doing again. So you need to think, how sustainable, how can you do it? Okay, next slide. A basic feature of a typical export contract. What is expected to be in an export contract and what you're supposed to do. Now, one is quality specification. You should tell your buyer, ask him, what is the quality you want? They will tell you moisture content, they will tell you the weight, they will tell let them state it in writing, what is the quality? Because you may think you are giving them something good, maybe you are even giving them the best product, but they will return back to tell you, this is not what we want. So make sure they tell you the quality. It should be specified. Next is quantity specification. No, please go back. Quantity specification. What is the quantity? How many tons in a container? Then how many containers? If they tell you they want 15 tons or 20 tons in a container, try to add like 2 tons. Instead of them to say is under, they will tell you it's over. I think that one is better. You can tell them, okay, remove it, keep it, keep that over, or I dash you. You understand? So, but that quality, make sure, quantity, make sure it's specified. Next is packaging. Very, very important. It's even more important than the export itself, you know? I remember when we had this seminar in Abuja, Nikon Leisure. So the seminar is on export. Nasima organized that. So I spoke with the chairman, and I told him we have paint to export to Mali. The man was like, good, good. Do you make the paint yourself? I said, yes, me and my friend. They said, okay, I would like to see the paint. I said, okay. So we quickly did a quality paint. Then we looked for fine coat rubber. You know fine coat paint? And we looked for fine coat rubber and we poured the paint inside and covered it. Then we used sack bag to carry the paint to his office in Abuja, inside town. So after waiting for him for some hours, he later said, okay, Mr. Akechukwu, please come, come, come. We got to his office and he said, you said you have paint for export. I said, yes. He said, good, let me see the paint. I drew the sack, removing the paint. He said, no, this is not what we want. We don't export this. I was like, sir, this is quality paint. I have brush here. We can go outside and test it somewhere. He said, no, this is not what we want. You can't export this. No, you can't. You can't export this. Then he opened his drawer and showed me some cashew, you know, showed me granite packet for export. This is what we can export. I said, but you say we can export paint. He said, no, you don't understand. You can't export it that way. Then it now dawned on me that what he's referring to is packaging. Now, I tried to write something one day, and I said, good, I remember the story. And I said, if you have very good product with bad packaging, you may not even sell at all. It's good, wonderful product, bad packaging, you won't sell at all. But if you have sheet, as in sheet, you know, and you package it very well, you will sell but once. You know, people will buy. Somebody will just see it. This thing, if I know. They don't even know what it is. Something I did in a shop right Ikeja Mall. I was hungry that day. I wanted to buy bread. So I saw this bread and they put a sesame seed on top. The thing was calling me, you know, nice. I said, okay, let me try this bread. The bread is even more expensive compared to the big loaf. I said, okay, and heavy too. Just one bite, I found out this is not the kind of bread I eat. It's for diabetic patients, you know? That bread is good for diabetic patients, not me. But I bought that bread not because of anything, but because of the packaging. As if you see the way they seal the nylon and the sesame seed on top, you will fall in love with such bread. So since then, if I walk through the shop right and I see the bread, I'll just... Packaging, very, very important. Different between kpekere and plantain chip is what? It's just packaging. Sometimes even kpekere is even more plenty compared to here. Yeah. And it's even sometimes even more nutritious. You know? Kpekere, you buy 15 naira and you are okay. But the plantain chip is just packaging. They put sugar, put pepper. Tell you pepper plantain chips, you know. Ginger plantain, just packaging. So please, that should be noted. You ask your buyer, what type of packaging do you need? What do you, as in, how do you want it? Do you want it in nylon first, before in tin, before in carton? Now, before you palletize it, before you now put it inside the container. Or you want it, like the contract we have for charcoal, they want it in loose form. They don't want it bagged. Just pour it inside the container. They want it in bulk. But some will tell you, bag it. Some will tell you, put it in 20 kg bags. I think my guy is here. He's outside. He's coming. So I thank God somebody is going to take me out. At least somebody that is bigger than me will tell us more about the export too. Okay. Next, contract duration. You ask your buyer, what is the duration, as in how long can you give? Some will just tell you 1 month. Some will tell you 2 weeks. It takes 2 weeks for a ship to sail from Lagos to Hamburg. And somebody tells you 1 month. Where will you start sourcing the product? And because you want to do the export, it's okay, I want to do it. And one thing with exporters, buyers outside the countries, it's as if they have this cartel. If they put mark on your name, nobody will buy from you again. You have to make sure you ask them the contract duration. Shipment date, you also tell them when they are expecting, okay? Then pricing, Incoterm, origin of the goods, inspection agents like I said earlier, port of loading and port of discharge, shipping line, payment terms, payment method, document, and you also discuss how do you resolve dispute when it arises, you know, where and where. If you are doing with a China man, don't agree for him to say you are going to do it in court in China. You will pay more if you're going to China, and when you get there, you will need interpreter, you know. They'll tell you, Ching Yang Ho, you don't know what they mean, and you just say yes. That is the acceptance in you. Next, is there another one? Next. Okay, non-commercial exports. These are exports that are not commercial. You take them out, but you don't get any returns, as in a non-commercial export. One, machinery and equipment for repairs and return. There's some machinery you import, and they gave you guarantee that if there's any issue, you can send it back, so you don't need to... That one is non-commercial export. Next is machinery and equipment for replacement. If you want to replace the equipment, if it's not good, you want to replace them. Machinery and equipment being returned after execution of specific contract, like the Chinas, they do that a lot. They bring their machinery to Nigeria after finishing, if they finish their contract, they will take their machinery back. Trade samples, gift, and personal effect. Trade samples. You know, when you want to show somebody, this is what I have. There are trade samples, gift, even personal effect. When you are traveling to let's say, to the U.S., you carry some luggage, and you can even carry some gari and all this thing, join body. They are non-commercial export. Empty container, they are non-commercial export. Okay? Items being re-exported. Maybe you export something, and because of default, or maybe there are some things there, they send it back to you.